Yeah, and the next goes is the diagnostic measures, like how you can clinically you can identify the pulp chamber or something anatomy is by using some dyes. Any of the dyes can be used, but the most commonly used dye is the methyl blue, where you can clearly see like methyl blue, it spreads along the finish lines. Okay, you'll have the fusion lines and everything, so it spreads along the fusion lines, or it spreads along the dentinal map and stains it. So by using your dental operating microscope, you can have a better identification. And I hope this is again a question related to your irrigation. Okay, so this is a Chamfe's test, right? So this is a bubble test which is done or performed with NaOCl as irrigation solution. As you know that NaOCl is going to dissolve the vital pulp. So whenever you have a vital pulp, this NaOCl is going to dissolve. So whenever you have a mist canal, this NaOCl is going to dissolve the vital pulp and it's going to release the bubbles. Okay, so which helps in identifying the mist canal, or helps in identifying the calcified canal orifice where you have a vital pulp. So it's a test that is useful in knowing it, by which you can indirectly know the anatomy of the particular teeth, that's the internal anatomy of a particular teeth. The next goes is, of course, the clinically used one is radiography. So radiography remains the primary source. It can be of different types. The latest thing that can be used as of now is the CBCT. CBCT has a high value, which is a type of radiographic imaging, right, where you can see the morphology at different levels and in different angles. Okay, so a normal IOPA should be tried in two or more different exposures with different angulations to know the number and the position of root canals as well as the roots. And you can try scanning electron microscope. This is again done in extracted teeth, by which you can determine the size of the apical foramen. You can see this apical foramen, right? So by which you can determine the size of the main apical foramen and the distance from the anatomical apex and the size of the and the accessory foramens that are present around the root. Your scanning electron microscopy can also be useful. And coming to, as already discussed, CBCT. CBCT is the best aid as of now in dentistry, as of now in endodontics in specific, to know all the important vital details which are not visible to the naked eye, or where you can see an MB2 here in the maxillary first molar. You can see an MB2 which is missing over in the obturation. You have done three obturations, but there is a fourth canal, that is MB2, is missing, where you can see and identify and conclude with a perfect CBCT. Okay, so of course, I mean, like, you can have many cases. The CBCT helps in knowing the morphology of the tooth, which includes the location, which includes the number of canals, which includes the pulp chamber size, which includes the degree of calcification, which includes the root structure, the directions, curvatures, fractures, microfractures, iatrogenic damages, and extent of the dental caries, which are not visible to the naked eye. That's the magic of CBCT. Okay, so in this particular content, you can see a maxillary first molar where you can see 5 canals. Regularly, we used to have MB1, okay, your palatal canal, your distobuccal, right? So, but in this content, you can see that extra canals. Okay, you can see that MB1, you can see mid B, you can see distobuccal, you can see MB2, you can see 5 canals. Regularly, we see 3 plus 1, that is 4, but you can see an extra canal over in this particular case, which can be identified well with the CBCT. The percentage of identification of this particular content or this particular anomalies will be the percentage will be more with CBCT, okay, than with the human eye or by using the dental operating microscope alone. Then the latest advancement came into existence, that is dental operating microscope, where you can see a different magnification. So when compared to the naked eye, this dental operating microscope has a better property of identifying the missing canals with the magnification and with the color difference between the dentin and the floor and the wall. Okay, so by which you can identify your dentinal map and you can search for the extra canals basing upon the probability. So coming to the importance of the pulpal anatomy, okay, here you have to learn few important areas where your questions move. I don't want to go very deep into this. We'll go up to the level of the MCQs, because most of MCQs will move around the most commons. Okay, so the most important thing that you have to make a note is over 60% of the lateral canals, okay, are more common in the maxillary center. And when you're talking about the maxillary lateral, you have to make a note of palato gingival groove. So this palato gingival groove is most commonly seen in the case of maxillary lateral incisor. So that's the reason why you have more palatal abscesses in maxillary laterals. When you talk about maxillary centrals or maxillary anteriors, are the most common teeth prone for trauma. Maxillary anteriors are the most common teeth more prone for the trauma, and that's the main reason why you have more radicular cysts or radicular periapical cysts in the anterior region, because they are more prone for the trauma. And you have some basic information. This is a very good table where you can learn some basic information, number of canals or the number of roots and all this stuff. And apart from this, again you have to make a note about the particular content when you're talking about mandibular incisors. So when you're talking about mandibular incisors in most of the cases, that is around 20 to 40%, is you can simply remember a star value here, that is 41.4% of the cases you can see two canals. This is a recent AIIMS question. Okay, 41.4% of cases you can see two canals in the case of mandibular anterior teeth. Similarly, another important question you have to make a note when you're talking about mandibular second molars. Mandibular second molars are the most common teeth which shows C-shaped canals. C-shaped canals are most commonly seen in the case of mandibular second molars. Okay, so these are the important, very, very important questions that you have to make a note when you're talking about individual specific teeth as of now. So the next one, these are some basic things. Okay, so the tooth can be divided into crown and root. You have your crown part, you have your root part, and various contents, like you see enamel, you see dentin, you see pulp, you have your cementum over there, right? You can see your periodontal ligament, which is so overlining the cementum. Okay, so this is a normal tooth structure, and the crown part of pulp contains coronal pulp, and the root part contains the radicular pulp. Okay, so the pulp is divided into coronal pulp and radicular pulp, and coronal pulp is the one which is present in the crown part. Okay, which is located centrally in the crown. Okay, and of course this is a question that is given in the NEET examination. Okay, the coronal surface of pulp has six surfaces. What are they? One is the roof, one is the mesial side, digital side, and the buccal, lingual, and the floor. Okay, make a note, the answer is 6. The question was given, the coronal part of the pulp has how many surfaces? The answer is 6. The next goes, your pulp horns are nothing but your projections. They are the projections which are moving towards the roof of the pulp. And of course, these pulp horns will be highly placed in the case of young patients, and that is the reason why your crown cutting is contraindicated in young permanent teeth. We regularly go for which crowns? There we will go for the stainless steel crowns. Okay, once the deposition of dentin is done, the size, the horns will drop down, then we plan for a permanent restoration. So regularly we give stainless steel, which is considered as semi-permanent restoration, semi-permanent crown, or a temporary crown. I mean, bestly called as semi-permanent crown is given, followed by the proper deposition of the dentin and the pulp horns are dropped down. You go for a permanent crown in a young permanent teeth, and that is the reason why you should be very, very careful while you are preparing your cavity preparation on young permanent teeth, because pulp chambers are very high. There is a high chance that you can expose the pulp. So coming to the radicular portion of the pulp, is present below, from the root canal orifice to the apical foramen. This content is called as the radicular pulp. So that's a wonderful saying we always say, is that pulp is a tissue which is concerned with the main issue, okay, which has main issue because the pulpal pain, if you talk about the pain of the pulp, pulpal pain is one of the I mean, like, if you take the intensities of the pain, pulpal pain has the best intensity, okay. That is the first pain that human being experienced is the pain during the birth, during the delivery. And the second pain after the delivery comes the pulpal pain. So it's a small tissue. You can see the pulpal content, you can see very small content of the pulp, but if you see the issue that is created by the pulp, it's going to be huge. That's a one favorite saying of every endodontist, right? The next saying is the, when you compare with the anatomy from the entire body, from your tip of hair to the tip of the toe, the most complicated anatomy is the pulpal anatomy, which cannot be understood by any one of us. That's the most complicated thing. Okay, the next comes the anatomy of the brain, which is the most complicated thing. So in the entire body, the most complicated anatomy is pulpal anatomy, and the most complicated pain, of course, it's very easy to treat, but the most complicated pain is again a small tissue with a huge issue, is your dental pulp. So next comes is the scientist names. These two scientist names are most commonly asked. So I simply remember we are talking about root canal, right? So RC, what I say, you can easily remember, okay, R, and canal can be, I call canal as K and L, right? So you can remember it as K. So you can remember these two scientist names, RK, okay? They are mainly concerned with the landmarks, and they talk more about the principles, okay? So they analyzed 500 pulp chambers, and they concluded that there is some important landmark, okay, some important landmark, that is the cemento-dentinal junction, cemento-enamel junction, okay. Your cemento-dentinal junction, which is a landmark where your working length is going to end. When I'm talking about working length, I'll be stressing more about the cemento-dentinal junction. But when you're talking about the identification, you need to talk about more about the cemento-enamel junction. So cemento-enamel junction is a very important landmark where you can locate your pulp chambers and the root canal orifices. Your root canal orifices and pulp chambers will be at the level of cemento-enamel junction, where your working length is going to end at the cemento-dentinal junction. Right, so basing upon this, he has conducted and he has came out with two important laws, two different types of laws. One is relating the pulp chamber to the clinical crown, and relating the canal orifice to the pulp chamber floor. So these are the two category of principles that he has given. So coming to the first category of principle, in which you have three principles: the law of centrality, the law of concentricity, the law of cohesion. So what the law of centrality says? The law of centrality says your pulp chamber is always located in the center of the teeth, of the tooth. So it's always present in the center, okay, in the center at the level of CEG. Means once you start from occlusion, slicing it, at the level of CEG, you can see a pulp chamber which is located centrally. The second one is the law of concentricity. So what the law of concentricity says, that the walls of the pulp chamber are always concentric to the external surface of the tooth. Means your pulp chamber walls as well as your pulp chamber anatomy, in most of the situations, it replicates the external surface. How the external surface looks like, your pulp chamber in most of the cases, it looks like the same. The third law says that law of CEG. CEG is the most constant repeatable landmark for locating the position of the pulp chamber. So you're slicing from occlusion to CEG, where CEG you can see this. So that's the law of CEG. So all these three laws are very, very important. The next comes the law of symmetricity. Okay, the law of symmetry 1 or 2, it can be considered. So what does the law of symmetry 1 says? That except for the maxillary molars, make a note, this is exception for the maxillary molars, the root canal orifices are equidistant from the line drawn in mesodistal direction through the pulpal floor. So when you draw a line from the mesodistal, most of the canal orifices are equidistant from this particular line. That's what the principal law symmetry 1 says. Law of symmetry 2, again, except for the maxillary molars, the orifices of the canal lies on a line perpendicular the line drawn from. So you can see this is a perpendicular. First, it is equidistant. That is a law one. Second is perpendicular, means 90 degrees. That's a law two says. Coming to the next one, that is law of color change. What does law of color change says? The law of color change says that the color of the pulp chamber floor is always darker than the walls. You can see the floor, which is darker in color when compared to the walls, which are lighter in color. The next principle is law of orifice location 1. So what the law of orifice location 1 says that the orifice of the root canal are always located at the junction of the wall and the floor. So this is a wall, okay, this is a wall and this is a floor. So most of your walls are located in junction between these two is the orifice location 1 says. What is orifice location 2 says? Your root canal orifices are located at the angles between the floor and the wall. Okay, you previously we were discussing it is the junction between the wall and the floor. Now it is the angle between, means it can be in the junction or it can be in the angle. Okay, so this is going to be the junction or it can be between the angle. It can be any of these places. So then the last, then the next one is orifice location 3. The orifices of the root canal are located at the lines of fusion. I was already discussing, but this is a fusion line where your methyl blue, whenever you apply methyl blue or any dye, it spreads along the fusion lines of the development or along the dentinal map where you can identify. That's the orifice location 3 says. The next comes, there are few other minor anatomical modifications which cannot be seen with the naked eye but can be observed with your operating microscope or with your sectionings or many other things that what we have learned. So when you take, I'm talking like working length is related to a particular landmark. What is that landmark? I was talking about the cemento dentinal junction. So your cemento dentinal junction divides that apical area into two areas, that is the dentinal canal and the cemental canal. Okay, you have these two canals which are of very very minor importance. And if you see or if you observe this particular area of this dentinal canal and the cemental canal, your dentinal canal is very narrow in the apical area and the cemental canal opens in that particular direction. So your dentinal canal is going to end where your cemental canal is going to come, and this is what indirectly related to the your major constructor and the minor constructor. And if you say this, if you take this cross section and if you observe under a microscope, you can see this as a morning glory flower. Morning glory flower appearance, or you can consider it as a funnel shape. You can simply consider it as in a funnel shape. Okay, it looks like a funnel shape. It's look like a flower, right? So the next comes are some root canal ramifications and few things you are already you are well known and few things you are unknown. So try to focus more on the unknown things. First one is the main canal, and I hope you know this. Main canal is something like which is present in the longitudinal axis of the teeth, passing from the roof of the pulp chamber to the apical foramen. And the second one is you can see a collateral canal, which runs parallel to the main canal. So you can see another canal which runs parallel to the main canal. But if you see the size of your main canal and the collateral canal is of less size. You can see a smaller collateral canal. The next comes is the lateral canal. Lateral canal, you can see this lateral canal, mostly it can be perpendicular or it can be angulated. It can be anything, but it's not associated with the, I mean, it's not in the direction of your main canal, okay? And it can be seen in your cervical region or in the middle region, but directing towards the periodontium, PDL. But most of the situations, it will be perpendicular. The next comes is the secondary canal. Secondary canal shown to be in the apical one third. It can be either perpendicular to the main canal or not, but it is always directing towards the PDL. The next goes as the axillary canals. Axillary canals are ramifications of the secondary canals. So your secondary canal is present in the apical area, and at the end of this secondary canal, you can see a multiple ramifications. These are called as axillary canals, which are directed towards the periodontium. Then you can see an intercanal. Intercanal means this is your main canal. You have your small collateral canals. So the connection between the main canal and the collateral canals is called as the ramifications between the main canal, collateral canal or secondary canal, okay, are called as intercanals, but they never reach the periodontium. So make a note, they never reach. Until now we are talking about most of the accessory extra canals which are reaching the periodontium, but this is an extra canal which never reach the periodontium. It just interconnects the main canal to collateral canal or the main canal to the secondary canal. You can see in this diagram, you can see main canal. What is the main canal? This is the main biggest one, right? So this is the biggest one, that's the main canal. Second one, you can see collateral canal. You can see collateral canal which is running parallelly, okay, but not as size of main canal. Then you can see the lateral canal. The lateral canal in the cervical or a middle one third, which is mostly perpendicular to the main canal. You can see secondary canal. Where your secondary canal is there? Your secondary canal is mostly in the apical one third. Your secondary canal is mostly in the apical one third. And the next comes is the intercanal. Intercanal is the interconnection between the canals, okay, that is interconnection between the main canal and collateral canal. You can see an interconnection between the, this is the main canal and this is a collateral canal. You can see an interconnection here. This interconnection you can consider it as intercanal.